Hello, welcome. I'm Molly Moore. I'm president of Southern Maryland Audubon and excited to have you all here and for our speaker, Kerry Wixted. Kerry has been a naturalist for the past 15 years, studying the flora and fauna of Maryland. Right now, she's the amphibian and reptile and invasive species program manager at the Association of Fish and Wildlife Agencies. Many of you may know her from her previous position at the Maryland Department of Natural Resources. She holds a BS degree in Wildlife and Fisheries Management from Frostburg State University and an MS degree in biology from West Virginia University. She's one of the all-time great speakers, and I'm going to now turn it over to you, Kerry, for some wild sex.
Thanks, Molly, and thanks for the invitation to speak on a fun subject tonight. I hope you all are rearing to go and ready. But first, a quick disclaimer: there are going to be some strong sexual themes, graphic descriptions, and some jargon-like information that's going to talk about how essentially nature does it. So just to keep that in mind as we get started. And this could be also the venue to discuss these types of things, with your kids. If you have any kids present, it's important to learn about things like whether or not turtles and tortoises are the same thing, right? And then also the birds and the bees and the bugs and everything else in between. So I would like to say that this talk is dedicated to my husband Dan, and it's not what you think. It's because one day he looked at me and he asked me, "How do porcupines do it?" And I was like, "Very carefully." I mean, that was just my first thought, and just said it right out. And he's like, "No, like really, like how do they do it?" Me being snarky wasn't enough for him. He wanted to learn. So I had to look it up, and then I was like, wow, this is quite impressive for our rodents here in Maryland. So it's not quite what you might imagine, and you're just gonna have to wait till the end to find out that major question of how porcupines do it. And I'm gonna take you up from different taxa groups until we get to our mammals. So in the beginning, organisms only produced asexually via clones, essentially. And some species still use this tactic, and some of them only use this tactic. For example, if you bake and you use yeast, yeast have that budding asexual reproduction, which you can kind of see here on the screen. However, 99% of multicellular organisms like to exchange genetic material. So you don't just have that, that essentially genetic clone happening. And so that genetic material can be exchanged with one or multiple partners. Really depends on that organism. So sexual reproduction, when you have another partner involved or partners, as you'll learn throughout this talk, this can be costly and time-consuming and sometimes downright deadly. But in the end, it helps increase that genetic diversity that we see in the different species. So, and also, it's important to remember that variety is the spice of life, and it's more fun, right? So, some species use asexual reproduction also as a backup plan. And so things like daphnia, which are these little organisms that you can find in the water, they're little crustacean-like organisms, they can reproduce via parthenogenesis. Essentially, the females can create clones of themselves. A little fast there. So the daphnia can create clones of themselves, so it's essentially like a virgin birth. Same thing can happen with Komodo dragons. So they also can reproduce but via parthenogenesis, and they think that Komodo dragons have evolved this trait essentially because they live in very isolated habitats. And about a month or two ago, you might have been caught up in the hype with Charlotte the stingray. She is a stingray that all of a sudden became pregnant in a tank full of male sharks. And so there were a lot of theories about whether or not one of the male sharks in her tank was getting a little close to her. And when she eventually gave birth, they did find out it was not due to the sharks in her tank, but she also was reproducing via parthenogenesis. So essentially, you know, having female birth. So one of the things I wanted to start off with is orchids. And I'm not going to talk too much about plants, but I did want to talk about how orchids have really deceptive reproductive tactics. So I really find this fascinating. And as a bot nerd, you know, orchids have always been my jam. So these gorgeous plants actually have a dark side, at least sexually deceptive dark side. And that's because a lot of these orchids essentially deceive pollinators and other organisms into pollination with little to no reward. So for example, on the screen, you can see some of these Australian orchids that actually smell and look sort of like female wasp. And so essentially you can see here the orchid reproductive parts, and then this is the male kind of coming in because he thinks that it is a female. But the females are wingless and remain underground until they're ready to mate. And then once she's ready, she's going to move up and the male will find her via scent. So these orchids have actually evolved these chemical pheromones that attract the wasp, and their reproductive parts look very similar to those wasps. And essentially those males, unsuspecting males, will come in, think that they're getting lucky with a female wasp, but not realize that it's actually a plant that he is mating with. And by doing that and visiting multiple plants, they're moving the pollen along to help them out, help those plants out. So we also, locally, we have our lady slipper orchids, which also have some deceptive pollination tactics. And in another month, we'll be seeing these yellow lady slippers, which are rarer in Maryland, and then the pink lady slippers, which are pretty common in Maryland, especially in Southern Maryland, where it's a lot drier and more acidic soils. So pollination in lady slippers actually involves deception and entrapment. So it's pretty much the same process for all of our lady slipper species, at least here in North America. These flowers have little to no nectar reward that they give to back to their insect pollinators. So they have to deceive them and trap them to pick up pollen and then make sure that poor bumblebee or whatever pollinator decides to visit another plant as well. So the shape of the slipper is part of this process. So this right here in the lip and all of that, it encourages these pollinators, and usually it's bees, a lot of times it's queen bumblebees, to kind of crawl in there. And sometimes flies or beetles will also do this process. They enter through the fissure, and then they find that they get stuck down here in the slipper of the flower, and they roll all around. And while they're rolling around, essentially they're getting pollen and other things stuck to them. And during that process, they are picking all that stuff up. And eventually, when they figure out how to squeeze back out of that slipper, they'll be covered in pollen. At least that's the hope of the plant. And when that happens, they hope that the plants at least hope that they'll visit another plant to fertilize that other plant. So interestingly enough, at least in our pink lady slippers, you can tell if a pollinator has visited, because you will see these modified sepals here on the side, those little twirly things. So they stick straight out when the flower hasn't been visited, but if somebody's visited one, you're gonna see it go down, and if both of them are down, then both sides have been visited by a pollinator. And you can see on this picture that I took of a pink lady slipper, you can see those reproductive parts right there in that fissure. So that's where those pollinators are going in, and then they get stuck down in there, and then they have to crawl back out and pollinate the plant in that process. So it's a trap. Moving on to another plant or group of plants that attract their pollinators in deceptive ways, we have things like figs. And if you like figs, what we think of as the fruit of the fig is actually a modified flower. It's called a syconium. And so technically the flowers are on the inside of the fig. And then if it gets pollinated, then it develops that fruit inside of that fig. So essentially the structure, the syconium, releases a scent that's enticing to female wasps. So this one also has a relationship with wasps. And when she burrows into the fig, she loses her wings. And then she pollinates those flowers, like, you know, she's going in and distributing pollen and all of that in the process. She often also deposits her eggs inside of the figs, and they will also, the young will develop inside those figs and drill out. And I forgot to mention, when they drill out, they get pollen that they pick up in the process. So when they find their own fig to fertilize or lay their eggs in, when they drill in, they're bringing that pollen from whatever fig that they were born in. So it completes the life cycle, essentially, with this wasp inside the fig. So if you've ever eaten a fig and have crunched on things in that fig, those are actually fig seeds. Some people will say that they're, you know, dead wasps, but the wasps are so, so tiny that pollinate this plant. You're never ever really going to find them. But I like to sometimes tell people that you're eating wasp if you're eating figs. And I still eat figs because they're delicious. There are also other plants that are essentially stinky to attract pollinators. So if you think of things like our jack in the pulpits, they actually have a bit of a musky scent to them if you give them a good whiff. And if you smell things like actual skunk cabbage flowers, which were out a month or two ago, they also have a specific scent. And there's some larger plants that also use these stinky tactics. So this is the one of the largest flowering plants in the world, the Titan arum. And there's me. I was really excited because this one was flowering at Longwood Gardens, and I was trying to catch it during peak bloom, but I was a little early. But essentially, these flowers are in Indonesia, and they get up to 6 feet tall. And when they fully bloom, they smell like rotting meat. And essentially, it attracts flies and beetles that help to pollinate those plants. And you really got to work hard in the forests of Indonesia to, you know, you've got a lot of competition in those types of areas to bring in those pollinators. So that's why they smell really, really bad. I didn't get to smell much of this plant because it wasn't in full bloom when I visited, but I did smell a little bit of the rot even through my mask during that point. So that was a cool experience for me as a nature nerd. Moving on to some insects. So we're getting ready to be in lightning bug season in another month or two. We actually have some of our spring lightning bugs that are out and about right now, but they don't glow quite as much as some of the summer species. So there are femme fatale lightning bugs happening out in our backyards, and you might not even realize it as you're watching those little glows in the night. So there are Photorus females that prey on Photinus males. So they're two separate genuses of fireflies. So the females will actually flash that yellow light special, and the males come calling. She'll make the flashes of Photinus females, and those Photinus males will say, "Oh, look, I found the lady. Let me go visit her." And when he goes to visit her, the Photorus female will actually eat him instead. And then also the other wild thing about this is when she ingests those rival males, she also gets those chemicals, I'm going to butcher the name, it's leucobufagins, which makes her toxic to predators like spiders. So not only is she getting a meal out of it, but she's protecting herself from spider predators in the process. So the next time you're in your backyard and enjoying all of the firefly symphony and light orchestra and all of that, just to run, understand that there might be some murdering happening in the process. Another thing that you might see and you might think, oh, that's so cute, but it actually might be slightly sinister, are our local odonata, which includes our damselflies and our dragonflies. So I remember the first time I saw these mating wheels, particularly with the damselflies, it looks like they're in a heart and they sit on leaves in this process. And I was like, oh, that's so cute. Look at that. Like they're making a little heart as they're mating and all of that. And then it was actually, I learned from Richard Orr, who's a local odonate expert. And he told me, well, Kerry, it's not that cute. Because you see, the colorful ones in these pictures are the males. And if you notice, he's actually attached to her head. And so, you know, what he does is he'll actually like drill down into her head to claim her so no other male can mate with her. And then they make these little mating wheels while they're copulating and all of that. And it's so bad because sometimes these males are so aggressive in this process and they can actually like damage her exoskeleton by attaching to her, that some of the females will actually play dead to avoid mating with some of these males. And then there are other wild things that happen, like some dragonfly males on the back end of their tails, and I'm forgetting the name of it, but they have this scoop-like appendage where they can actually scoop out the sperm from rival males and put his own sperm in there. So they're really, really super competitive. And I guess to pass on your genes, you've got to be that competitive in the world. So wild stuff. Moving along to an insect that you probably don't like, including me, there are these bed bugs, and bed bugs actually have this wild mating process called traumatic insemination, and it's exactly how it sounds. So the males are smaller than the females. You can see the male attached to the female right here in this picture on the left, and the term for the males penis is called a lanceolate paramere, and I like to call it a stabby thing, because essentially what he does is he stabs her, like in her abdomen or wherever he can. He'll grab onto her and he stabs her, and he essentially inserts his sperm into her body cavity. And this is in part because she doesn't have that opening on her body for mating, so he just like stabs her wherever. And apparently when he inserts the sperm, it also has like these special immune cells that protect, you know, that opening and that thing that he's created on her from bacteria getting into her. But sometimes it doesn't always work. Sometimes he traumatically inseminates her and he kills her in the process. So he doesn't have a very good success rate. On the second picture here, you can see a female that has been successfully fertilized, and that is that that spermalodge or that sperm packet that he has inserted into her right where that yellow arrow is pointing. So wild stuff. Moving on to red velvet mites. These are something that you might have seen in your backyard. They're really, really common. I used to call them chiggers until I knew better, because they're actually not chiggers. These little trombilids, so they're in the mite family, they have like wild mating habits as well. So essentially the males will use things like sperm and create a little silken trail, silken sperm web, leading to a packet of sperm that he deposits. And so what he'll do is he'll sit there and dance and wave, and females that come by that are attracted by him moving around and weighing, once he gets her attention, she'll come and visit, and she'll follow that little silken web of sperm that he puts out. And usually this is on like a little twig or a blade of grass or something like that. So if she, while she's following that sperm trail that he has put down, if she likes him, likes his dance moves, and likes what he's offering, he will have a little sperm packet, and she will sit on top of his sperm packet and fertilize herself that way. Sometimes if rival males will find each other and they find somebody else's little sperm garden and their packets and all of that, the rival males will actually destroy the whole area and create their own trail and web and sperm packet and all of that. So all of this is going on down in the ground, in your gardens, might even be happening in your houseplants, and you might not even know it. So fun times. So another invertebrate that I want to talk about that's local, that's really wild, are horseshoe crabs. And this is me from a couple years ago during the major breeding season. And so the horseshoe crabs on the East Coast, whenever it's a full moon and high tide in May and June, literally thousands come upon the shores, and especially like Delaware. Delaware's a great spot to see this. This is where I was at when this picture was taken. And they all come up and they have this amazing breeding frenzy. And so these horseshoe crabs, you're going to see bunches of them attached to one another. And usually when you see a big pile, the one at the bottom of the pile is actually the female. Usually the females are larger. And then you'll see like multiple males kind of stacked on top of her. And so what the males will do is they take their walking legs and they actually clasp underneath the female and attach to her. And so he attaches to her, and as she moves around and eventually lays her egg, the first one that's attached to her is the most likely to be able to fertilize her eggs as she starts depositing them and all of that. Interestingly enough, the females have been found to prefer males with cleaner shells. So the males that have like a ton of barnacles and other like limpet shells and things like that on them, they are less attractive to female horseshoe crabs. She wants a nice clean man. And the other thing is that if he's missing legs, that also is going to put him at a disadvantage to be able to successfully grab her in that process. Occasionally, you'll also get these younger males, and this is usually when you get these pileups. You'll notice that there's a larger male and then smaller males towards the back of her. And you can kind of see a pileup down here that I'm pointing to. And so some of these smaller males, maybe the ones that are less preferred because they're covered in barnacles and stuff like that, they'll also kind of hang on and hang near and pile up, because they will try to essentially externally fertilize some of the eggs that she deposits as well. So it's just a wild breeding frenzy, and it happens at the full moon. And then literally you'll see thousands of them one night on the shore, and the next day, almost nothing. It's just wild how it is just so so quick to happen and everything. And I hope if you haven't gone out to do it, you get to go and do it sometime soon. It's totally worth it. Moving on to spiders. For those that know me, I love spiders. And I think one of the things that has gotten a lot of audiences to also enjoy spiders is how I talk about their crazy sex lives. And so I've got two spiders that I'm going to cover on this slide. And one of them is the black widow. And you're probably really familiar with black widows. They get their name from the females usually killing the males. And that's not unheard of in a lot of spider species. Most spiders, the females are significantly larger than the males. And a lot of times they do make a male out of those males because it makes them nice and useful. And some species, there are males that will actually sacrifice themselves to the females because the more nutrition that she has after fertilization, the better eggs and embryos she's going to produce. So it's just built in that they are eaten in that process. But for some reason, the black widows get the bad name. Black widows, the story that you might not know is that the males, and this is not a black widow male, but this is a picture of another widow species. And I have this picture because these big things that look like boxing gloves on the front, those are enlarged pedipalps. That's how you can tell a mature male spider versus an immature male spider or a female spider. They'll have those pedipalps in the front, but they will not have what looks like giant boxing gloves on. So the males, again, much smaller than the females. And what they do is the males will spin a sexy web, and he will essentially put his sperm on that web. And then he takes those pedipalps and sucks up that sperm into those pedipalps. So he's walking around with those boxing gloves or pedipalps filled with sperm. And then what he'll do is essentially try to find a female. And the female, to attract the male, she is going to spin a web, and she's going to deposit her pheromones on that web. And that web is going to tell him a little bit more about her. It can tell him a little bit more about her fitness. It can tell him if she's mated with someone before, all sorts of other things that he can tell from her pheromone-laden web. And a lot of times these males will prefer to mate with virgin females because they're less likely to eat him afterwards. Anyways, if he finds a female web that he's interested in and he likes her style and all of that, he'll start to gently pluck the strings on her web. And if she is also receptive to him, then he will just take those sperm-filled pedipalps and insert them and fertilize her there. Occasionally, what he will do to ensure paternity is he'll actually break off his pedipalp inside of her just so nobody else can mate with her. So that is one of the deceptive techniques that these male black widow spiders occasionally do. And then she often will eat him in that process, or he'll die because that broken pedipalp is going to have like a wound that is going to cause him to dehydrate. So if he mates with her successfully and doesn't die, then he'll live a little bit longer, and he might even get a chance to mate with another female. But most of the time, it's one and done for our local black widow species. Now, on the other side, there are other species like our nursery web spiders. And this is an example from European nursery web spiders, but our American nursery web spiders might do the same thing. And in this image here, you can see the male, and he actually has this silk-laden gift that he is presenting to her. So the nursery web spiders, to mate, the male has to bring a gift. The bigger the gift that he gives her, the longer that she will mate with him. However, sometimes they found that, these males will occasionally wrap something else up. Instead of like a nice juicy fly to give to her after mating, he will wrap up things like exoskeletons, twigs, or plant fibers, wrap it up, try to pass off this false gift just so he can mate with her. And they found in the trial studies, when given like different objects that the males could select from, almost 40% of the time, these males deliberately chose fake gifts to give to the female. Now, obviously, if she figures out that he's trying to pass off fake gifts just to mate with her, then she's going to eat him on the spot. So the cost is a little calculated in these spiders, but it's still like crazy to think that they're out there, you know, trying to deceive one another just to mate. So I always say it happens in the spider world too, folks. If you've been to my spider talks, you've also probably seen and heard about my love for jumping spiders. And jumping spiders are this group that really I can get a lot of people behind because they're just so darn cute. And their mating practices are to sing and dance to attract the females. And if he doesn't do it right, then he will be eaten on the spot. So I'm gonna play part of this video. These are peacock jumping spiders from New Zealand. So they're a lot more colorful than our local jumping spiders, but our local jumping spiders do have some of their own dance moves. Also to the tune of Staying Alive. Hopefully you can hear that. the males are going to do is start shaking their legs, trying to get her attention. And then he's going to bust out that butt. Show it off. Those dancers. And she is much bigger than him. So if she does not like him, then she will eat him. And if she, you know, decides that after mating she's hungry, she will eat him too. It is a spider eat spider world out there. Okay, still going on. I'm going to do my last invertebrate and then we're going to get to some vertebrate species. But this is also something that you all might have seen in your backyards. These pictures are actually from right outside my door, and the video is from right outside my door. So the reward for reproductive acrobatics goes to the non-native leopard slugs. So these are, I think, a European species that we have here in Maryland. And what they do is they secrete these slime trails that helps one another find themselves. And then once they find each other, they will attach themselves to they're horizontally attached to a surface like my wall in the back of my house here. And they twist all around and hang upside down. They start sucking on each other, so they'll start sucking on each other and doing all sorts of stuff, and then eventually this blue alien-like penis will come out of their heads and twirl around. So you can see some of it, both of them. So this is both of their penis organs essentially intertwined into one unit. And they twist all around and exchange spermatophores, which are capsules of sperm in the process. So you can see it here in a much more twisted phase. And it like turns like a translucent blue in the process. So it's really trippy looking as well. And it takes a while. And the whole time, like they're slowly, slowly sinking down on this slime thread while it's happening. I might have watched this for like 20 minutes or so because it was just so fascinating to me as a naturalist. And I have found out from conversations with other people that I'm not the only one who has viewed this. So feel free to pop it in the chat if you also have seen this process in your backyard so I don't feel so alone in my voyeurism here. So moving along to fish. So sperm competition is really high in a lot of species. So as I said, with the horseshoe crabs, you've got those satellite males that kind of hover around and take advantage of the more mature males and occasionally get lucky in terms of fertilizing her eggs. And so the same thing happens with our local bluegills. And so bluegills have three main mating types. There are the parentals, the sneakers, and the satellites. And it takes 7 years for a bluegill to become sexually mature and be able to make their own nest or be one of those parental type bluegills. And so the sneakers, it takes them 2 to 3 years. They're usually 2 to 3 year old males. And then the satellites are 4 to 6 month old males. So this is a picture locally, and you will, if you're in these areas that have bluegills in it, like in ponds and rivers and all of that, you might start to see these little circular pads that just kind of show up. And you'll notice like all of the mud and the sediments wash, like pushed away, and usually just gravel is there at the bottom. So you'll see all these like circular appearances in the bottom of the water. And those are those nests that are being guarded by the parental males. So those parental males, those older males, will make these beautiful nests, and he'll sit there and he'll wait until a female comes by, and then he will court her. And if she likes him, she will lay her eggs in his nest and he will fertilize. So in that process, he's doing all the work in terms of maintaining the home and all of that. And he'll actually even guard the nest for a little bit even after she's gone. But those sneakers, those 2 to 3 year old males, will literally watch in the wings, wait in the wings until essentially, you know, he is courting a female and she's getting ready to externally release her eggs. He will sneak in and fertilize those eggs as soon as he can and then sneak out before he gets attacked by that parental male. So hence the name sneaker. The satellite males are actually 4 to 6 month old males, and they will actually pose as females. And so the parentals, those mature males, will think, oh, I'm getting lucky. I'm attracting two ladies for the price of one. When in actuality, one is a mature female and one is that satellite male. And once the actual female releases her eggs, that satellite male will release his sperm and try to fertilize as much as possible before that parental figures it out. So another crazy thing in the world of fish are anglerfish. And I remember learning about this in high school marine biology, and it has always struck me through the years. So anglerfish, as you probably know, live in these deep sea habitats without light. And they've evolved essentially without a mirror too, given their appearance. But for a long time, scientists were only catching females. And they couldn't understand, well, what happened with the males, or are they parthenogenic like some of the other species that we know about? And so they actually noticed some of these females occasionally had weird appendages stuck to them. And somebody looked a little bit further and they found out that those weird appendages were actually the males. So the males are super tiny compared to the females. Their only goal in life is to find a female and attach to her. And he actually joins into her and becomes essentially a living, breathing sperm sac that fertilizes her on the outside. So if he doesn't find a female, they literally don't even eat. They could starve to death as a virgin. So really odd mating strategy that they have. Oh, there's that male right there, just to show you an example of how tiny they are compared to the females and that they really got nothing to them. Moving on to snakes. Our snakes are starting to come out, and garter snakes actually are well known for their mating frenzies. And we don't get these mating frenzies that you see in more northern climates, but we do get some of these small mating balls that you might see. So this picture is actually from Canada. And in Canada, there actually is a place, Narcisse, Canada. It is known as the Snake Town, and it's a place I want to visit one day. But essentially, thousands of garter snakes will come out of their hibernation all at once and form these giant writhing masses of mating snakes. And so in this picture, the one that is bigger that you can see right here, that is the female, and all the other ones all over her are males. So when the females come out of hibernation, they release a pheromone that brings all the boys to the yard. And literally, like, it just, they will, as soon as they smell her, they cover her, and they're all just trying to mate with her, just like with other species. And so in colder areas, they've actually found that some of these younger, weaker males will actually mimic females, and they'll release scents similar to a female just so other males will kind of converge on him and warm him up and also protect him from predators, which is just mind-boggling to me. But he can be like quite a few males to one female, and they're all just racing to try to mate with her and be the lucky one, and not all of them are. So locally, I've heard a lot more reports of things like water snakes being found in these mating balls, but garter snakes are also known to do these mating balls on occasion. Moving on to our turtles, this is another picture from my own backyard. And these were some box turtles that found each other and decided to try to make new box turtles in the process. So box turtles take anywhere from 5 to 10 years to reach sexual maturity. And when they do, the males, they're mostly solitary animals. So during mating season, which is May and June here in Maryland, that's when you're going to see a lot more box turtle activity. They're going to be moving around trying to find one another and mate with each other. So if a male finds a female, he will chase and bite her. And the first time I saw this, I thought it was because one was smaller, which was the female, and I saw the larger male, and I thought the larger male was going after the smaller male in my yard. So I took the smaller one to give it a little bit more of a, I felt bad for it getting picked on. And then I realized when I picked it up, it was a female. So I interrupted that one time. This time I caught them totally in the act. And you can see in this process, so he will get on top of her, he will bite her and all of that. And eventually he will hook his back legs to the back of her. And sometimes this can be...
She's doing one on wild sex in the animal kingdom, how animals mate.
Sorry, you're getting a little feedback there. So he will hook into the back end of her. And sometimes this will cause some like puncture damage and all of that to her body. And then they have the cloacas in their tails. So they'll essentially touch their cloacas together to be able to mate. So I had to laugh because he was making some faces. He also had this beautiful slug stash. So he had a nice meal that was still dangling from his head in that process. And eventually he will dismount. And a lot of times he will fall over on his back when he dismounts. And you can see that this is the male right here because you see a little bit of that indentation on the underside of the shell. And that indentation is what allows him to essentially be able to get up and get up on top of her shell. So because they're mostly solitary, they don't always find each other every year and all of that. They have found that females can store sperm up to 4 years at a time. And so so they can, you know, store that sperm. And if they don't meet a male 1 year, they can still essentially fertilize their eggs and have babies. Okay. Moving on to some birds, had to add some bird examples since this is Audubon. And I thought I'd add some examples of maybe some species that you might not be quite so familiar with. So one of them is something I just learned about, are these crested auklets, which you can find up in places like New Brunswick. And essentially what the auklets do, they've got three main tactics to attract a potential mate. And it's a little different than what you might think of. A lot of times in the bird world, the males are the showy species and have this amazing plumage or song that they use to attract the females. Well, the auklets, you're probably looking at this amazing crest that he's got on his face, or it's got on its face. Both the males and the females have the crests, and they choose one another based on their crests. So not only is the female picking a male, but the male is also deciding whether or not he wants to mate with a female. So it's not just about the crest and all of that. They also have a smell. And apparently it is a citrusy smell, almost like tangerine that they secrete. And when I think of a colony of auklets, I don't think of it smelling like tangerines, but they have this scent, and then they also, their bills are also fluorescent, and this is something that they just recently found. So once a male is interested, he will start courting females, and what he does is he'll show off his crest, he'll start honking. You can see that he has made his pupil, this is probably a male, because they made their pupils super, super small and showing off the white parts of his eye. And he does all of this. And while he's doing this, a bunch of other auklets are going to come in and start egging him on. And it's called a scrum. So a scrum of auklets get together. And when the female starts to check him out, he will determine whether or not he wants her based on her crest. So if he likes her, she likes him, then what the next step is she is going to give him a rough sniff, which is essentially jamming her face down into the feathers on the back of his neck. And that allows him or allows her to get to that source of that citrusy scent. And so apparently the back of the neck is where it's the strongest. Maybe that's where it's released from. And so she can get a little bit more idea about how awesome he is with how orangey he smells on the back of his neck. And if they're both receptive to this after the rough sniff, then what they're going to do is cackle and touch their bills together. And then they start twisting their necks around and rubbing. And then in this process of rubbing up on one another and twisting all around, that scrum is also going to get engaged in this courtship. And you're going to have as many as 15 to 20 birds piling up on the central pair, cheering them on and releasing more of these citrusy smells to essentially get the mood going. And so this is like, talk about a watch party here for mating auklets. So moving on to flamingos, had to just show this because they're just so cool. So I didn't realize that flamingos have up to 136 courtship dance moves. And so you can see, like in this video, you'll see some of the head flagging where they're moving their heads around. You'll also see some of the wing flashes. So the wing flashes are where they're kind of showing off their wings and showing off their colors. The males and the females will do these dance steps together, and they do saluting, so they're moving their head up and down.
During the breeding season, the flamingos perform the...
So they do all these different dance moves, and it's not actually well known like what dance moves really get each other to select one another. But they researchers do think that some of the coloring is, you know, when they do those wing flashes and show off their necks and their coloring, some of the mate selection might be due to the coloring, and the dances help show off the color. And as you might know, the color is in relation to fitness because the color of flamingos is due to their diet. So check out some more flamingo dance videos when you've got some time. It's really cool to watch. Last bird I'm going to cover are the ducks, and you might be familiar with ducks and their habits. You might have seen where you'll have multiple males kind of tag team a female. And so ducks, particularly like mallard ducks, they're not monogamous, and they have this forced copulation that occurs. And forced copulation is so common in the duck world that the duck vagina, which you can see on the picture to the right, has evolved these wild, quaint, and crazy twists and turns, and essentially blind ducks. And the male's penis is corkscrew shaped to kind of go up and into that wild, twisty vagina. But if she is not receptive to him, it is going to be more difficult for him to successfully fertilize her than if she was receptive to him. So if she is receptive, she can actually relax her vagina. So those blind ducks are going to close off, and it'll make it easier for him to successfully fertilize. Amazing that this evolved in these species. Now we're getting into some mammals. Had to talk about these little critters. This is a species called Antechinus. So they're not around here. They're over in Australia and places like that. And they have this like catastrophic mating cycle. So the males take up to, the males essentially will mate until they die. So they mate up to 14 hours at a time for 2 to 3 weeks, until all their hair falls out and their body disintegrates and they literally die. And researchers don't know quite why all the males essentially kill themselves in the mating process, but they think it might be due to resource limitation, that after they go through all this mating and all the males die, then the females have less competition for resources and can focus on essentially eating the limited resources and giving to their fitness, so they're going to have healthy young. But that's just a wild strategy there. Moving on to our local possums, you might be interested to know that at one time, settlers believed that possums mated through their nose. And they thought that they made it through the nose, and then the female sneezed out the little possum babies into her pouch, because they would see her, you know, rooting her nose into her pouch, and then eventually the babies would appear. Researchers obviously have figured out that they do not mate through the nose. And the reason they thought they mated through the nose is because males have a forked penis, a bifurcate penis. And the early settlers thought, well, the only place that she has two holes is her nose. So obviously it goes up the nose. People were not smart back then. Anyways, they eventually realized that not only does he have a forked penis, but the female has a forked uterus. And so that allows her to have greater room to carry lots of babies. And they can have, I think, 13 babies at a time or something like that. So anyways, they don't mate through the nose, and they have lots of little babies, and they don't live very long. Moving on to some bats. In some bats, they have to warm each other up. So in some flying foxes, the males will actually groom themselves to present themselves to the ladies. And we'll put groom in quotation marks there, and how he might groom himself to get ready for her. And then there are also some fruit bats where essentially, if the female provides oral services to the male, mating will actually last twice as long. So they will do that in that process. I can't speak to the habits of our local bats, but I can say that our local bats all mated in the fall. And so they store the sperm over the winter. And right now, as they're coming out of hibernation, they are becoming pregnant, and they will be giving birth very, very soon. So I'm gonna get into just a couple of our local species really quick. So a few things that might have been, you might have noticed, February, you start to smell a lot of skunks, and that is because it's skunk mating season. Also in February, you will occasionally see things like groundhogs showing up outside of, you know, Groundhog Day and all of that. Those are actually the males that are trying to find the dens of females, because they are so antisocial, they have to den up for a couple weeks before they can successfully mate and emerge in the spring, which would be now. Obviously, you start to hear some of our bird species calling too, trying to attract mates and set up territories. And then our toads also are in the mating processes right now. And so you might hear some of our trilling toads and all of that fun going on. So as I promised in the beginning, how do porcupines actually do it? So they have 30,000 quills. So yes, they have to do it quite carefully. And the females are only fertile for 8 to 12 hours at a time. So to let the males know that she is fertile, she is actually going to create a musky scent, like a musky pheromone, vaginal mucus and urine mixture that she releases, and that's going to attract the males, and the rival males will battle it out. And once the one male who's the successor gets to visit her, he will pee to let her know that he is interested. And if she likes his urine, then she will essentially lift up her tail and allow him to mate with her. So that is wild sex. And there are some books out there that you can learn a lot more, and there are podcasts like Naughty by Nature and the Wild Sex podcast. So you can satisfy all your needs for what's happening with the wild world.
Kerry, thank you so much. I think nobody's going to look at their partners quite the same tonight.
Yeah.
So we'll open the floor to questions for Kerry. If you have questions, you can feel free to unmute yourself and ask away.
Stunned you all into silence.
So I do have one, Kerry.
Sure.
So we have these two mallard drakes that live in the marsh to us. And they appear to have sex with each other. What's the story on that?
It's not uncommon in ducks, and certainly in other bird species, they have found male-to-male relationships. They essentially will enjoy it with anybody. So I think there have been some penguins that have actually pair bonded as well, like some penguins at the zoo that were male-to-male pairs. So.
Cool. Any other questions out there? Don't be embarrassed. You can ask her anything. As you've seen, she'll talk about anything.
All the wild stuff. I see a question about squirrels. So I have not gotten into squirrel sex, but I imagine it's pretty similar to a lot of other mammals. So the males usually do not stick around in the squirrel, at least in the like the gray squirrel and the other tree squirrel world. So it's usually the females that are stuck raising the young and doing all that stuff.
So, Kerry, one thing, I'm sure you've heard about the problem with the men mating and the ospreys, and that the ospreys in some parts of the Chesapeake are now having fewer chicks. Has there been any evidence of change in mating habits because of that?
That's a good question, and I'm not sure. I was only just recently tuned in to the menhaden osprey issue, so it wasn't something that was on my radar until just a few months ago. I didn't realize how big of an issue it was in the Chesapeake Bay region. And so, in some species, when there is that lack of resources, you do see some of that reproductive, they'll pull back from reproduction and everything. But I don't know enough about our local ospreys in terms of what happens there.
Yeah, and it also may be too new a phenomenon to have got a lot of data on.
Yeah,
There's
yeah.
some question. Can you see the chat box? There's some questions appearing there.
Okay, yeah, I see a question from Linda about the beetles at the beginning of the program. Were they in the act? And yes, those are actually dogbane beetles, which are a native species of beetle. They are really super colorful, and you'll find them on dogbanes and occasionally milkweed. And usually the easiest way to get a picture of them is while they're in the act. So. And then Kimmy asks, what happens after leopard slugs intertwine their parts? You said there were two pheno parts. Do slugs have both? And yes, slugs are hermaphrodites, so they prefer to mate with another. And just like with worms, they're also hermaphrodites, and so they will mate with another organ, another individual, and that exchanges that genetic material, which is what they want. So, yeah, but eventually they will keep falling down on their slime thread and then disentangle and then go their separate sluggy ways.
Cool. Any other questions out there? Well, this video will be recorded. So any of you who want to have the sex talk with your kids, you're welcome to use this recording on our website. And Kerry, can't thank you enough. This was really fabulous. I'm sure we all learned a ton tonight, and we're going to look at all the critters in our yard a little differently. So thank you so much, and thanks everybody for coming out and watching Carrie.
Thank you all.